Good morning from Clay Terrace. We're a north side neighborhood of Carmel, Indiana, which is a north side neighborhood of Indianapolis. So thanks for joining us. We'll be opening 2 Corinthians today and kicking it off. Pastor Andy Hunt will be doing the initial lead on that. And then Pastor Jim Wright will chime in later in the in our hour, and we'll see, try to better understand what God is trying to communicate to us through the Apostle Paul in his second letter to the church at Corinth. So that'd be cool. Hey, you could join us any Friday morning, 8 a.m. Eastern, details at clayterrace.org, clayterrace.org, and that is where our various videos are then found. So you could go there anytime. Pick out any chapter that we've studied and hear a diverse discussion, and then be good Bereans and look it up yourself. So that's our attempt here. And that said, Holly's going to pray for us. Then, by the way, we'll be doing an introduction to the book. We won't be reading. Usually we read, but we won't be doing that this morning. But Holly, would you pray us in for some of the requests we've talked about already and any of them that might be unspoken? Thank you.
Father in heaven, we thank you. We can come and gather in your name to study your word and learn your ways. Lord, we just ask for those requests that people who were sick, ill, that you will touch them. Rejoicing about Terry's son and other things. We just thank you. We ask that you have mercy on Andy and his wife as they travel at this joyous time for this wedding, and bless him as he travels, his wife, and bless the wedding. Lord, you are so all-encompassing. We cannot fathom your ways, but we can today learn a little bit more about you. And we take this bread as being the word, which is bread, and take it as being your life today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. We're looking forward to what God has to share with us in 2 Corinthians. And we're just starting off with a brief introduction this morning, understanding that Paul is the undisputed author of 2 Corinthians. I know that there are others who will look at chapter 6, starting at 14 to 7:1, and try to say that he's using unique vocabulary concerning an epistle from Paul, a Pauline epistle. But if you look at it in detail, you'll see he's just quoting a collage of scripture. Now, 2 Corinthians is actually the fourth letter that Paul sent to the church in Corinth. There are four different observations I want you to see here. Look at 1 Corinthians 5 and 9. 1 Corinthians 5, 9. I wrote to you in my letter not to associate with sexual immoral people. Now, he's referring to a letter that he's already sent them. That's one. Now we're talking about the fact that 1 Corinthians, that's two. And then I want you to look at 2 Corinthians for just a moment. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. Really, you can take it chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, okay? 2 Corinthians chapter 2, 1 through 4. For I made up my mind not to make another painful visit to you. For if I cause you pain, who is there to make me glad but the one whom I have pained? As I wrote as I did, so that when I came, I might not suffer pain from those who should have made me rejoice. For I felt sure of all of you that my joy would be joy in you all. For I wrote to you out of much affliction and anguish of heart and with many tears, not to cause you pain, but to let you know the abundant love I have for you. Bless you. So that's the tearful letter that's mentioned in 2 Corinthians that we have never really seen in its entirety. And then the fourth reference would be to 2 Corinthians, which we have before us today. Now, Paul wrote this from Macedonia about AD 55, 56. And this is 1 year before he wrote the letter to the Roman church. Now, all of Paul's epistles have a theme, right? And this theme lifts up here in 2 Corinthians as a relationship between the suffering and the power of the Spirit in Paul's apostolic life. Look at the Philippians 3 and 10. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. Not that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and share and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in death. And go to 11. That by any means possible, I may obtain the resurrection from the dead. Paul, again, wants us to understand the cost and the desire and the depth that we must go into if we're going to really serve the Lord. Look at 2 Timothy 1 and 8 for just a second. 2 Timothy 1 and 8. Paul speaking again to his son in the ministry. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in the suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began. So Paul is dealing with different attacks in 2 Corinthians, people who are calling into question Paul's motives about organizing the collection that he's collecting for the believers in Judea. They're challenging his personal courage. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 8 for just a second, verses 20 through 21. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 20 through 21. Here I think they're challenging the fact of his collection. We take this course so that no one should blame us about this generous gift that is being administered by us. For we aim at what is honorable, not only in the Lord's sight, but also in the sight of man. And then if you stay in go to chapter 10 of 2 Corinthians. Chapter 10, 2 Corinthians, verses 10 through 11. Take it up to 8. Chapter 10, 2 Corinthians 8 through 11. I think they're challenging his personal courage here. For even if I boast a little too much of our authority, which the Lord gave for building you up and not for destroying you, I will not be ashamed. I do not want to appear to be frightening to you with my letters. For they said, his letters are weighty and strong, but his bodily presence is weak, and his speech is of no account. Let such a person understand that what we say by letter when absent, we do when present. So again, here they are challenging the fact that he writes great letters, but when you see him in the flesh, he's weak in body, and he's not the greatest speaker. But Paul constantly is suffering under these, suffering from these opponents who are challenging his apostolic authority and the fact that he is really being built up. Paul argues for his weakness when we look at 2 Corinthians 11 for just a second. 2 Corinthians 11, start at 23. start at 22. Second Corinthians 11, starting at 22, going to 33. Here's Paul speaking. Are they Hebrews? So am I. He's comparing. Again, they're challenging the fact if he is really up to the task. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they the offspring of Abraham? So am I. Are they servants of Christ? I am a better one. I am talking like a madman. Now, here he is. He's giving them, again, Paul is not boasting, but he's just sharing the truth of his resume here. I'm talking like a madman with far greater labors, far greater imprisonments, with countless beatings, often near death. 5 times I received at the hands of the Jews the 40 lashes less one. Remember, they would give you 39 lashes because it was against the law to go over 40. So they would give you 39 and then give you one so they would have 40, right? 3 times I was beaten with rods. Remember, rods were what the magistrates carried around to give a symbol of their authority. A lot like now we see nightsticks or a badge or a weapon that the police carry around that gives them the symbol of authority as well. Then he goes on, I was stoned 3 times. I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and day I was adrift at sea, on frequent journeys, in danger from rivers, danger from robbers, danger from my own people, danger from the Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers, in toil and hardships through many a sleepless nights, in hunger and thirst, often without food, in cold and exposure. And apart from other things, there is a daily pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches. Who is weak? And I am not weak. Who is made to fall? And I am not indignant. If I must boast, I would boast of the things that show my weakness. The God and the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is blessed forever, knows that I am not lying. At Damascus, the governor under Arius was guarding the city of Damascus in order to seize me, but I was let down in a basket through a window in the wall and escaped his hands. So all the suffering that Paul deals with really embodies the message of the cross. It shows his endurance during great adversity. And he was a sign of God that would show great thanksgiving and contentment with the mission that God sent him on. Yes, Neil.
Hey, when you read that passage, man, it was much more vivid than it ever has been. Jan and I watched a documentary that is now available for free on Prime for a little while. It's called The Last Apostle, and it's a documentary by a PhD from Huntington University, which is right here in Indiana. And he's an archaeologist who travels extensively in Turkey, in the area of the seven churches, and it's awesome. So he himself is quite the photographer and has like a myriad of great photos. But this is a documentary as a team went to just follow him around, and they were kind of kidding about you know Indiana Jones, the professor who goes on these wild excursions, right? So they call him Indiana Mark. Dr. Mark Fairchild. So if you at all get a chance for 2 hours of just great viewing some evening on Prime, it's called The Last Apostle. It'll give you a real appreciation for what Paul is talking about here in terms of the rugged terrain they went over and you talk about robbers or, you know, potentially pirates, which affected all the coast along there. And he says archaeology will show that it pushed the good folks inland away from those pirate coves and the like. And thus they had to go to this really high, rugged country. And yeah, it's something to, and you're right there. I mean, he's going, see this Roman road? Absolutely. You know, this is one that Paul would have traveled on. So I'm right here in his footsteps. Anyway, it'll make scripture come alive.
Praise God. Praise God. I want to close my part of this with what Paul says in 2 Corinthians. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. This is one of my favorites. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Pick it up at verse 1, and we're going to go to 18 and then hand it off to Jim here. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 18. Therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. Now, people are challenging Paul that if you were really this powerful or anointed, you wouldn't spend this much time in jail and under persecution. Now, Paul says here, therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. I am not disheartened, right? We have renounced disgraceful, underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word. Stop right there. Paul is saying that these other people who seem to be more successful, they are using underhanded ways. They're using human cunning. They are tampering with God's word. To tamper with God's word is to adulterate it. It's like merchants used to do when they went to Jewish festivals and they didn't bring enough wine. They would water it down so they could take care of all the people who needed a drink, and they can still have a great profit. He says, we don't do any of that, but by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. Now at 3, he's going to tell us why, even if those people seem more successful than he is, there's a reason. Look what he says in 3. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. What's the word perishing? Apollumi. What does it mean? To be sent to hell. You know, when we go to John 3:16, and it says, you know, about the fact that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That contrast would be a lot more distinct if they would use words that would give you the connotation of perishing, meaning being assigned to hell, versus perishing sounding like you left milk out overnight. Because the contrast would be, you know, those would be assigned to hell or receive everlasting life. So Paul says here, even if our gospel is veiled, it's veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God, small g, of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ is Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, let light shine out of the darkness, has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay. Remember, we're made of dirt. God picked up a handful of dirt, blew into it, and man became a living soul. For we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. I love this here. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. Remember, you're not knocked out if you get up, right? And he goes on to say here, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that in life, Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. Since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what has been written, I believe, and so I spoke. We also believe, and so we also speak, knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus, he, personal pronoun, refers to God the Father, will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you into his presence. For it is all for your sake, so that grace extends to more and more people, that it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. Then he ends it up with this beautiful statement, 16 to 18. So we do not lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, that means every time I look in the mirror, I have one more gray hair and I'm losing, this image is fading because I'm getting older every day. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self, the inner man, is being built up and renewed day by day. For this light momentary affliction is preparing us for the eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. Paul is saying, and if you go back and start at the beginning of 2 Corinthians, you will see where he was challenged, that they were so challenged in their persecution that they wanted to die. And now you see a turnaround here because he understands that whether life goes from infancy to 99 years, it's a light momentary affliction because we who believe in Christ have eternal life. What's 99 years compared to eternity? So he says, for this light momentary affliction is preparing us for the eternal weight of glory beyond comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. So, I mean, it's a great encouragement to know wherever our lot is in life, that the Lord is preparing us for a greater existence far beyond our comparison, which will be eternal. This is a dress rehearsal. And I believe we should give it our all and do the best we can, but always keep in our mind's eye toward the upward progress of Christ Jesus, that he has prepared what no ear has heard, no eye has seen for those who love him. So God bless you guys. Have a great evening, a great day. And Amen. Jim, take it away. Be kind.
Hey, be blessed. We're praying for your travels. Be effective, Pastor Andy. Yeah, Jim, good morning. Uh-oh, you're on mute.
Oops, hello. Am I the evil villain that swoops in? And
yeah, sure.
I'm not going to do that. I Neil sent me this. I think I got the text last night and I was at a karaoke party. So I haven't had a chance to really.
You want to give us a few bars?
No. Then it was a lot of fun. It just hit me when he was talking. I mean, if you go back to chapter one, I mean, it seems that one of the big themes, there is a letter missing between, I agree with Andy on this, that there is a letter missing between 1 Corinthians and then 2 Corinthians. And it seems to me, just listening to Brother Andy, it really, apparently in that, some of the questions they had was really dealing with maybe the age-old question we all struggle with, right? Why does God allow pain? Why does God allow suffering? And that really seems, in a lot of ways, the thread that he's running through a lot of Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, is dealing with that. I know we probably weren't going to go through chapter one, but that's the only thing I know to do a little bit. If you want to do that, Neil, I don't know.
That'd be fine. Whatever direction you want to take it. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just, I think just real quickly, if we walk through chapter one, well, not all of it, but just the first part of it. If you just take a glance at the first few verses of chapter one, what's the verses you see all the time? Or what's the word you see a lot? Other than God, right, of course, and Christ. the word I constantly see here.
Comfort.
Comfort. Right. You got it. Comfort and God of comfort, verse 3. Verse 4, he comforts us so that we can comfort those. Comfort ourselves. Verse 5, we got comfort again. Verse 6, comfort. It shows up three times there, chapter verse 6. Verse 7, it's there. And then we kind of talk about affliction. So, I mean, I'm seeing comfort constantly in those first opening verses. And I think he's just dealing with some of the age-old questions here is, you know, why does God allow things to happen? Why is there pain? And I think the reality is, I heard a thing before we went on this morning. I'll just share with you. A pastor went to a barber, and the barber was, he told him, he's the barber. He goes, well, why are you a pastor? There is no God. And he said, what do you mean by that? He goes, well, you know, there's so much evil in the world, there can't be a God. And the pastor got his hair cut, walked out, and he saw a scruffy, hairy, homeless man. And he said, come with me. And he brought him into the barber shop. And he said, I got a man here who's all scruffy and hairy. And he said, why is that? And the barber says, well, he never came to me for a haircut. And he says, oh, you mean you exist? And the barber said, well, yes, I exist. The guy just never came in here and got a haircut. He said, that's exactly the same way it is with God. God exists. You just have never bothered to come to him. And, you know, so I probably slightly botched the story, but.
No, that was good.
But, you know, it was a pretty good little illustration. But, you know, we all know pain's a reality in this world. And, you know, one thing I get from 2 Corinthians 1 here, is that Paul's really talking about how God used their affliction to comfort others. And I think that's in verse 4 right there. He comforts us. And here's when he does it, in our affliction. Why? I always put these little questions in there. So that we, the apostles, may be able to comfort those who are in any kind of affliction. How do we do it? Through the comfort we ourselves have received from God. And we've got a young man in our church who's been attending. We've been discipling him. He's from India. And he's only been a believer a year. And before he came to Indy, he went to University of Texas, Arlington. And he was interested in God, but wasn't a believer. And he went on a trip and he shattered his elbow. And he had met a lady who's retired missionary, and she had been talking to him, but he hadn't become a believer. And he called her up because his mother lives in India. And he said, Ruth, I've shattered my elbow and I don't know what to do. And she said, well, she said, you know, weird thing is I broke my elbow 3 months ago. So I know all the doctors we need to call. And so she set him up, got all the doctors in he needed to go to. He was able to have a surgery. She got him connected with an agency that paid for like 90% of his surgery. And because of her kindness that she walked with him through this, he became a believer. And, you know, I look back and I think it seems like God let Ruth break her elbow so that Haman could become a believer. You know, and sometimes we go through difficult times and we don't know why God is allowing this to us. And really at the time, we may not even see it ourselves. But I think one of Paul's reminders here is that God may allow you very well to go through something because he has a mission for you later that you're going to be able to minister to somebody on a level that others can't. You know, my last church recovery ministry, and even today, more contemporary example. I have a young boy, man, he's 13, 14. He's gotten already in juvie a few times. He's just really messed up. He and his mom came to church. Well, I have another young man who just got out of prison. He's still got his ankle bracelet on. I've been discipling him too. And his name's Nate. And one day after church, this young man named Will and I were talking. And Will, you know, he wasn't listening. So I went and grabbed Nate. And I said, Nate, will you talk to Will? And he pulled him off to the side and spent 30 minutes just talking about, you don't want to go down this road. this is where it leads. It's, I've been in prison. And, you know, and of course we've been discipling Nate. And I just think that's exciting because he could talk to Will on a level I couldn't. He's walked that path. And I think, again, God allows us to go through maybe cancer or maybe loss or death or pain or whatever. And many times it's obviously, I think, for us to grow us in our own faith, to test our own faith, but also God can use that to minister to somebody else. And he may give us an opportunity to do that.
Yeah. Amen. Well, Jim, if I can throw this in, you know, isn't this one of the ways that we authenticate, you know, God's word? It was written by, you know, people who they weren't like high standing, powerful people in government and lived this great and prosperous life to our way of thinking. But they were like the Apostle Paul, you know, that they may have been there at one time, which he apparently was, and then had this conversion experience and suffered all sorts of things. So, you know, even in our culture today, we appreciate folks that we can look at and go, wow, he or she, they're really authentic. You know, their Christianity is not just, you know, blowing steam or combative, all sorts of things that, you know, people get accused of today. But you look at the Apostle Paul, there's no doubt that he was authentic. And as I said, when you watch that documentary, you just realize. And that, by the way, just one of the things is, like, they're climbing around high cliffs of things in order to get through these rugged places, and having to a lot of times go different routes in order to avoid certain folks. Anyway, but it's like it makes me appreciate Paul's poor eyesight, his apparently poor eyesight. I would, man, it, some of those places, it would be like, hey, yeah, just lead me along here. I don't want to look. anyway, so yeah, authenticity, the martyrdom of the apostles, you know, it helps authenticate that they were absolutely telling the truth when they said, hey, I saw Jesus. I saw him do the miracles. I saw him go to a cross and die. I saw him rise again from the dead. I saw him go into heaven. And I'm telling you, you know, it's real. So, yeah, I appreciate that about the Apostle Paul and many of the other writers of Scripture.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And, of course, I mean, a lot of people followed in their steps afterwards because of them. And, you know, when you go to verse 5, he says, you know, for as the sufferings of Christ overflow to us, so through Christ our comfort also overflows. And I think that's the key is it's, you know, it's through Christ that we're able to minister to other people and able to, you know, it's amazing because Paul's ministering out of his own affliction, right? So life's not easy for him, yet in the midst of that, he is ministering to people in the midst of that suffering. And I mean, like what you said, Neil, I mean, there's so many stories even throughout church history of, you know, I was thinking of Mark and Rinkert, who I think wrote Now Think We All Are God, or Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah, one of those hymns. You know, he lived through the bubonic plague. And I think at one time he did like 5,000 funerals a year. It was insane. And one of those was his wife's. And yet he could write Now Think We All Are God, you know. And so in his pain, he still ministered to people because it was through Christ. And I think, again, I think pain is a great revealer of what we're made of, right? Do we really believe or do we not? Do we really trust or do we not? It's easy to minister to people when life's going easy. It's another thing when everything gets turned upside down. And yeah. And I think
that reminded me. Go ahead, Jim.
No, I go ahead. I'm just rattling.
Well, I was just thinking in Matthew in particular, in that gospel, it's pretty apparent that midway through Matthew, maybe about chapter 16, he up to that point, it's been Jesus healing people and, you know, talking to him and loving on him and so forth. And, you know, I'm sure the disciples probably thought, okay, so the message of the kingdom is your best life now. It's the prosperity gospel, so to speak. Right. And then he says, but, and by the way, he had told many people, his disciples, hey, don't go telling everybody yet, right? But in chapter 16, then he says, and then he began to teach them that he was going to have to go to the cross, and that they too, you know, would have to suffer for the name of Christ. And suddenly, not your best life now, but in fact, you know, the side of the character of our God that somehow is self-sacrificing for his creation. And boy, that's a high and weighty thought to me, but that's the teaching of the message of the kingdom, that it's not just glorious prosperity. And certainly Paul continued that teaching.
Yeah, Sunday, I've been preaching through the Gospel of Luke, and I got to the passage on the Beatitudes in Luke chapter 4 or chapter 6. And I thought, oh, Beatitudes, blessed are the poor. I've preached on the Beatitudes, a whole series on them, but I've never preached Luke's Beatitudes. And as I started working through it, I found myself saying, blessed are the poor in spirit. Luke doesn't put in spirit. Luke only has 4 Beatitudes, not 9, and they're all physical, poor, hungry. They don't have the spiritual flip side that Matthew does. And I wrestled with that for a day. And I was like, why is this? And again, I would argue that Jesus probably taught the Beatitudes on more than one occasion. And this is one of those, you know, some people think it's the same one as Matthew. I think it could have been probably another look. But I was like, why is Luke's not meshing up with Matthew's? Because if you look at Luke's Beatitudes, they're all physical. They don't have really a spiritual flip side like Matthew. And I always wanted to insert that. Blessed are those who hunger. Of course, Matthew is hunger and thirst after righteousness. Luke doesn't say that. And, you know, my conclusion was he's addressing two audiences at once. Luke is writing to Gentile believers. And then, of course, he's recording Jesus talking to the disciples who had just been appointed as apostles right before that, and the disciples. And I think it goes along with what you were saying, Neil, that, you know, that Jesus was becoming a rock star. And they were thinking, oh, this is going to be great, the Messiah. And I think Jesus is giving them a warning shot. One day you guys may very well be poor, but blessed are you who are poor, because the kingdom of God is yours. And blessed are you who weep, for you will be comforted. And I went back to Luke chapter 4, because I think that Jesus alludes to the year of Jubilee, the millennium coming in, but that's another topic. But you know, it's that whole thing, like what you were saying, because you're right. The first couple of years of Jesus' ministry, he did not reveal that he was going to the cross, because they wouldn't have handled it. I don't think they could. And they didn't even get it when he said it. But he discipled them for a couple of years before he really started talking about the cross. Big time.
Yeah. Well, certainly, you know, the Beatitudes and many other places, Jesus was really bringing to remembrance, you know, the Old Testament passages as well as to what this Messiah would be. And he was coming to free the oppressed, right? And so too often, I think we may tend to explain away to our comfort that, oh, he wasn't really that concerned about the poor or those who were oppressed. Like, yeah, he was. He sure was. Absolutely. And as I say, it's a remarkable side to God that he's not just a superman who cares little about those who have not been super. But in fact, you know, he cares much about those who have not been super.
Yeah. What I always notice is, and, you know, some believers, like, they may only believe that Christ redeems from sin. And they don't see the other, that he's life, that he's victory, you know. And God is so multidimensional that sometimes, you know, someone will focus mainly on one thing. Maybe they know he's all those things, but the focus is sometimes one-sided, and God is king, he's savior, he's Redeemer, you know, he forgives all our sins. It's the list goes on, you know, and we tend to like glam onto one thing. Maybe we need that one thing today, but we need to focus on the whole scope of who he is. That's the way I see it. But and sometimes though, I get mad because people accuse, you know, oh, so-and-so, they're only, you know, they only concern about, you know, what God can give them. But I think maybe they're focusing on one part because they feel it's being neglected, you know, but they really know the whole scope, you know,
Amen. Hey, Jim, do you have any thoughts? You said you concur with Andy about that there were multiple letters that Paul wrote, right? I think Andy enumerated four his thinking as to why that is. But of course, there are other folks, scholars that are going to go, no, what you see is what we've got. And, you know, references partway through a book to say, I wrote you earlier in my letter. Well, you know, so some believe that's just in the earlier parts of the letter, but anything you'd want to further illuminate us or let the Holy Spirit illuminate us on that aspect?
Not really.
And what would be the implications? What would be the implications? You know, if you say there are more letters out there, immediately my mind says, okay, and if Dr. Fairchild finds one of those laying on a Roman road there somewhere, then what? Is it part of canon suddenly, or it isn't? What do you think?
Well, my argument is you're not going to find them because God chose not to let them be preserved. the argument, what you're saying. If there's two other letters, why aren't they? And of course, I guess the Sunday school answer is they were not inspired by the Lord. Because the assumption is and everything Paul wrote was always inspired. And I think the answer is probably not. I mean, certain times he wasn't inspired. Perfect. Sometimes he wasn't moved by the Holy Spirit. And who knows, these might have just been brief little blurbs that he wrote to them. They might not have been nearly extensive. So my argument that I do believe there's probably a couple other letters. I think they're long, long gone. You're never going to find them because the Lord didn't see fit to have them preserved in any way or to be found.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
That's cool. Well, hey, yeah. Ben, let's say we cut to our Friday. It's Friday at Clay Terrace. How do we, we're thinking about this. Paul, we've just covered Paul's first letter to Corinth on a variety of topics. Now we're opening his second letter. Some of what we talked about, the sufferings and so forth, how do we apply this in our own personal lives, in our neighborhood, in our local church, whatever. Chaplain Tony, you've been awfully quiet today. Anything you'd want to chime in there? How do I apply this today? Hey, and by the way, for those of you who don't know, I think Chaplain Tony's done 5,000 funerals this year, haven't you?
I've done quite a few, that's for sure. I'm not at 5,000. I'm thankful for that, but I've done quite a few. Yes, yes. Yeah, I'm sitting here quiet. I had that shot this week, Tuesday for my sciatic nerve issue. So, yeah.
My second one
since March. So they really trying to help me here, and you can feel it today. I can feel it shooting down the side of my leg. But those are the things they said I got to go through for about 5 days. But today is one of those days.
I've been there. I understand that one.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. Right. But I love the topic this morning, especially the part where what we go through is to help someone else. What we go through is to help someone else. And that's one of the things they tell me at church sometimes. They say, hey, you always get some interesting people. that needs to talk to you. Then I start looking at the people, and then it comes to me that, hey, a lot of us had things in common, you know, before salvation. So the Lord really knows what he's doing. So I really like the topic this morning, you know, about your suffering, things you've been through. We're using it for him so he can get the glory to help others.
Amen. Any last, who would want the last word and or be able to pray us out? Well, golden opportunity. You get the last word. Oh, okay. All right. Well, anyway, thank you, Jim, for helping this morning. And as always, you know, giving us a perspective that it may coincide with Andy's perspective or anybody else's. It gives us some material to think about. And as I said earlier, you know, referred to the Bereans, who are called noble because they test everything, hold on to that which is good. They went home and searched it out for themselves. So, yeah. Very recently I heard in another forum, was talking about the Apollos was just a powerful preacher and accurate in what he knew. And then Aquila and Priscilla took him home after church one day, you know, and explained some things further to him that improved on the message. So we can all learn from each other. So thank you, Jim. If you'll pray for us, that'd be great.
Okay, let's pray. Father, we do thank you that you are the God of all comfort and that you comfort us in our affliction. And Father, you allow us to go through things sometimes in life so that we in turn can maybe, we can use those things to help others, minister to others, and to say we've been there, we understand that, and here's how you've worked in our lives. And so, Lord, help us to not view affliction necessarily as always a bad thing, but as something that can be used for your good and for the furtherance of your kingdom. I thank you for everybody here today. I pray for Brother Andy as he travels, that he'll have traveling mercies. And Father, pray for Brother Tony, that you'll just help him with his sciatica, that that'll heal up soon, and that the treatments will do their job. And we just thank you for this time we can gather, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. See y'all next week as we dive into chapter 1.